A very warm afternoon to all of you joined us today for this last day of Revolutionary International Webinar Series by Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association in collaboration with Homeopathy 360. So I'm glad that you guys have joined us today, and I, Dr. Yashika Arora, heartily welcome you all, and I will be the moderator for today's session for all of you. Before I begin the session and we introduce you to the platform of Homeopathy 360 and AHMA as well as the speakers of the day, I want to thank all the organizers, all the speakers, coordinators who have been with us throughout this series. First and foremost, I would like to thank Dr. Ubaidul Al-Hashmi, sir, who is the Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association, and also the national contact person for LMHI International for the country of Afghanistan. He's also the medical director and homeopathic physician at Afghan Mercy Hospital, Kabul, Afghanistan. We are glad that we had his support throughout this series. And also, I would like to thank Professor Dr. Kavita R. Chandak, ma'am, a classical homeopath. For PHMS, PGNIH and PG Home from London. She is working as a professor in the Department of Preparatory at PD Jain Homeopathic Medical College, Parbhani, and is an international speaker and trainer, and also one of the board member, also the board member of Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association. I would also express my gratitude to Mr. Manish Jain, the director of BJN, who is behind, who has this platform to organize this national, as well as first from this day one October, I want to Professor Dr. Michael Frass, sir, Dr. Azubar Turos, ma'am, Dr. Bahar Yevazi, ma'am, Dr. Mohammed Karim, sir, Dr. Javed Akhtar, sir, Dr. Kostas Chistinden, sir, Dr. Mini Mehta, ma'am, Dr. Kathy Mehon, ma'am, Professor Dr. Kavita R. Chandak, ma'am, again, and Dr. Today's speakers, we have Dr. Professor Dr. Kamlesh Mehta, sir, and Dr. Ubaidullah Al-Hashmi, sir, once again. So thank you so much, all of you, for being with us, being associated with this webinar series, as well as I want to thank the Dr. Chatterjee, ma'am, and Dr. Imran Khan, sir, as well as Dr. Shashwat Tiwari for coordinating and moderating since the previous sessions, as well as promoting this series. So thank you one and all. And now I think I should just request you guys to please visit the website of Homeopathy 360, that is www.homeopathy360.com. We are trying our level best to promote homeopathy and organize each and every single information related to homeopathy on this platform of Homeopathy 360. We are trying our level best to promote homeopathic knowledge through webinars, as well as publish your papers, your articles, your studies on the platform. For that, you can mail me at yashika@homeopathy360.com, or you can mail me the articles for our peer-reviewed journal also, that is the Homeopathic Heritage, the oldest, one of the oldest homeopathic journal, at hheditor@bjn.com. So I am glad that you guys always support us and is there with us throughout. And now I think I should thank Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association and introduce about AHMA. So it was founded in 2018 as the first Afghanistan Homeopathic Association. And we are the Afghanistan's leading homeopathic charity who is committed to the promotion and practice of homeopathy. We are trying our level best to collaborate with all the organizations, associations, and every person who is working for the upliftment of homeopathy together on one platform and unite them together so that we can bring homeopathy to the highest level of the system of medicine and make it available to all the people so that there is patient access, education, training, and research. We are trying our best through our Telegram groups and WhatsApp groups, as well as Facebook groups. You can join us on Facebook as well as WhatsApp and Telegram everywhere, and promote homeopathy. And now I think I should hand over the session to Dr. Kavita Chandak, ma'am. Before I introduce about the speakers of today, so I want to request ma'am to say a few words about today's session. Kavita, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Yashika, and welcome Mehta sir and welcome Hashmi sir. And today we have a very special person, Mr. Sukar, and I really pay my gratitude to everyone for their cooperation. See, like we make a garland by taking different pearls. So in AHMA, we have the different pearls from throughout the world. And Dr. Hashmi, credit goes to Dr. Hashmi because he always insisted everyone to join with him. And he never insist anyone or compel anyone to do anything. He just requests, and his words are so sweet that every person just wants to stick with him. He has such a magnetic personality. And second thing is that we have almost various speakers and various people, great homeopaths throughout the world in our organizing committee, executive committee, and we are working for the betterment of homeopathy. The day will come soon. Not only in the sky of Afghanistan, but in the sky of the whole world, the HMA will shine like a North Star, and nobody can replace us. So I'm really happy by doing this collaboration with Dr. Hashmi and everybody. And please keep audiences, please keep your connection with us, keep your love with us. We need affection, we need love, because see, we don't want money from anybody. We are not paying anybody. We are not getting anything from anybody. But we are here to share knowledge. And as much as you share your knowledge, you will gain more knowledge. You will never lose your knowledge. So, and we don't need anything. See, right now, at least in India, we do not need to pay tax to share the knowledge. It is not like income tax. So please be happy and share your knowledge. And remember only one thing, that homeopathy, every homeopath must say the same thing, which I always say every morning, that healing is my passion and homeopathy is my mission. So thank you, everyone. We will soon meet again with the new revolution series with Homeopathy 360 and Dr. Yashika. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a nice message always. You give something new to us. So thank you so much for your message. And now I think I should invite our both the speakers, as well as it's my privilege to introduce both the speakers who are so great in, I would say, they both have joined us from India as well as Afghanistan. We have one speaker. So I would take this privilege to introduce, first of all, none other than Professor Dr. Kamlesh Mehta, sir. He is actually an inspiration for so many homeopaths, and he's so dedicated and personally, I personally admire him so much, as well as learn a lot from him. He's such a genuine person by heart. And if you talk about his qualifications, he is actually working as a professor head HOD in the Department of Case Taking and Repertory at CMP Homeopathic Medical College, Sri Mumba Devi Homeopathic Hospital, Mumbai. Homeopathic clinician and educator. An executive HMA India. He's also the founder of Homeopathic Panacea and Hanumanian Gurukul, who is teaching a lot, promoting to their and he's also the head and coordinator of Homeopathic Pathogenetic Trial HPT at Homeopathic Medical College, and also working as the chairman of Ethical Committee at Foundation of Vital Healing, the other side. Today he is going to discuss with us perceiving a Hanumanian key, unlocking every individual case for homeopathic remedies. So I think you guys will be getting a lot to learn about the practical aspect of homeopathy by Dr. Kamlesh Mehta, sir. We also would be having Dr. Ubadullah Alashmi, sir, as our second speaker, the founder of AHMA and ACF, homeopathic consultant, physician, DHMA, RHMP, LMHI, National Contact Person of Afghanistan, and also working as the Medical Director and Homeopathic Physician at Afghan Mercy Hospital, Kabul, Afghanistan. He'll be talking about the current status of homeopathy in Afghanistan and what all he's planning and what all he'll be doing for the further process. So we have both speakers with us, and now I would hand over the session first to our first speaker, and I hope everybody is excited to learn from him. So over to you, sir. So your audio is off. Your audio.
Okay. Good afternoon once again to everybody. It is a great pleasure to be part of this event, which is an international event. And in real sense, it has become international, whereby two countries are coming together, Afghanistan and India. And speakers and participants from all over the world. So it is becoming really a global event. And this is a debut of Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association in the fraternity of homeopathy by starting the activity through this seminar. Moreover that, Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association by itself is an international, whereby all of its executive committees are from all over the world. So it is in real sense nothing national but international thing, where homeopathic fraternity is coming together and forming a fellowship. That is something very important. People say that no two homeopaths can come together. Homeopaths about the same patient can have a different opinions. But that Dr. Obaid has made a myth and misconcept that homeopaths can come together, they can share together, they can learn together, they can evolve together, and they can progress together. So that is with this. Best wishes to the Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association. We begin today's session. I welcome all the participants. It is a marathon series. Today is the last day, but not the least day. I'll share my screen. Before that, I would like to put one point to you all, that let us make this event an interactive event. It should not be a monologue from my side, but it should be the dialogue, so that we evolve together and understand the purpose of this webinar. I hope you all are ready, and host, the moderator will allow you to speak, and if you have something to say, raise your hand, never hesitate, and then we see that, we respect that, and it can be attended. Okay? So I am making a beginning by sharing a screen. At the outset, I really congratulate Homeopathy 360 also, along with Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association, for unitedly coming forward and making this event possible. Today, myself and Dr. Obaid, as Dr. Yashika has already said, we'll be sharing our views with you. And before we begin, it is a tribute to revolutionary gurus. The first one, the foremost, is Samuel Hahnemann, who rediscovered homeopathy. Dr. M.L. Dhawale for the standardization, and Dr. M.L. Sehgal for revolutionized homeopathy. So I begin the tribute by a small Guru Vandana. You may join with me. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. My earnest respect to my gurus. Gu means darkness and Ru means light. A one who has taken me and is taking me from darkness to light. Who is making me incapable to capable, who is making me confident from inconfident. So, such guru requires a tribute. With this, I begin. Thank you very much for joining with me. We begin with revolution. In homeopathy, it was by itself was a revolution. I will focus a little bit about revolution because this webinar is a revolutionary webinar. The foremost revolution in homeopathy, that was by Dr. Hahnemann. Rather, it was a revolution in the therapeutic science by introducing homeopathy to the world. Rather than the discovery of the homeopathy, it is a rediscovery of homeopathy. Homeopathy was already there in the nature. It is the part of the nature. It was there, and it is there, and it will be there. But Dr. Hahnemann brought a refinement, a development, and in such a manner that it can be applicable by every simple physician. Rather, the event when homeopathy was rediscovered, that was the time when actually allopathy was discovered. The terminology to the prevailing medical science was given by Dr. Hahnemann, allopathy. That it was termed as allopathy against homeopathy. Here, Hahnemann, as a point of revolution, gave a disease perception totally differently. He was the first one to talk about individualistic therapeutic treatment, customized therapeutic treatment, doctrine of holistic perception. You know, you are all homeopaths. It was not just a local part, a man that is suffering. Is a doctrine of causation, fundamental cause for chronic diseases. where Mayajam plays the major role, or exciting course, exciting the latent Mayajam, having acute disease. Doctrine of disease classification. He changed the classification into, even today, we stand differently from acute of the modern medicine and acute of homeopathy. Doctrine of disposition. This is the most vital and important disease perception, that disposition is a tendency, it is a propensity, which is the in the basis of development of all the diseases. Whatever condition that prevails and which is maintained, that cannot happen without disposition, except in the cases which are accidental type. And so, if we want to ensure cure, as it is said in aphorism number 2, whereby it is gentle, rapid, gentle, and permanent. So, if you are looking for the permanent, then without dealing effectively, without removing, without annihilating disposition, it cannot happen. He did not only define the disease, he also offered therapeutic measures. For therapeutic application, he gave law of similia, proving of the remedy, homeopathic pathogenetic trial, as it is said nowadays. That was a unique thing that was changing the world of medicine. Doctrine of dynamization, again a new concept, a revolutionary idea, that not the material, not the matter, but the energy. In that, completely threshing the idea of huge, massive doses to minimum doses, where even drug is imperceptible. And there is a fight of the world today that homeopathy is a fake science because there is no material. The entire world is materialistic. And that material world today is in the full step of homeopathy for going into the nanotherapy. So that was the revolution Dr. Hahnemann brought centuries back. Doctrine of analogy. Whatever is true for the part can be true for the whole. To overcome the limit of incompleteness from the patient's data and the materia medica. Though this idea of analogy was further enhanced by Dr. Bonifsen, but it was Dr. Hahnemann who introduced it. So that was a revolution in terms of homeopathy in therapeutic science by Dr. Hahnemann. Since we are talking about the revolution, I will not take you deep to the history of the evolution of homeopathy and the revolutions taking place in homeopathy. But some important points I will definitely like to bring to your notice, that Hahnemann, after that Dr. Jahr, was appointed in 1830. Subsequently, we have Dr. Bonifsen from 1830 in the contact with Dr. Hahnemann and Dr. Haring. And we know that Dr. Bonifsen introduced repertory. Not only repertory. He introduced, it was already introduced by Hahnemann, but the real form was given by Dr. Bonhoeffer. But not only in that, but he was complete in himself with regards to therapeutic of cough and fever, materia medica in terms of characteristics, remedy relationship in terms of concordance, and drug affinities. Two sides of body in such a short span of life, though he was not a homeopath, not a doctor, what a great dedication and a change he has brought in homeopathic world. Dr. Herring, who gave 10 volumes of guiding symptom, and not only that, Herring's law of cure cannot be overlooked at all. Moreover, from his 10 volumes, we have a beautiful nurse repertory. Bonhoeffer influencing Jar, and all these three influencing Dr. Kent. And Dr. Kent and Dr. Bonhoeffer influencing Dr. Boger. And now, what I want to bring to your notice, the revolution that what we are looking for is in the contemporary world. From Boger, we proceed to Dr. Dhawale. And from Kent, we proceed to Dr. Sehgal. So this is the evolutionary revolution that I brought in short to in front of you. And keeping this in mind, we will see that today's discussion. And feel free to discuss as and when you feel like. Dr. Aurora will coordinate and link up you and me. So don't worry, because I can't see you, but that doesn't matter. For me, you are existing. For you, I am existing. Dynamically, we are connected with each other, and that is what is homeopathic. Now, it is homeopathic only if prescription is based on law of similia. That is the eternal truth. No change has come so far in this. It is something like this. Analogically, I have selected this diagram because revolution by itself means one of its meaning is a rotation. And in that, when something is rotating, nothing remains same. The change is the only constant. And we have to understand that evolution is possible only if there is a rotation, only if the change that goes on and on and on. And that is what I put across here. There are physicians, for example, Hahnemann is homeopath, or he is offering homeopathic till the time he maintains himself in the axis of law of similia. And this law of similia, when he is going on, he takes up orbit, a complete turn around disease, so as to have overview, so as to have overall view, so as to have unprejudiced view, so as to have a total view of disease. Here what makes sense is the approach. There is holistic perception of the disease and individualistic perception of the disease. Dr. Dhawale also introduced his perception of homeopathy, contributed in enhancing the efficiency of the application of homeopathic principles. In that, I put across my third guru, that is Dr. M.L. Sehgal. Now we see, as a physician, they are different. They have their own orbit. But it has to have an axis, the same axis of law of similia. If their work, the functions, their contribution goes out of the axis of law of similia, then their contribution is not homeopathic. Or we may give any other name, no problem. But it doesn't, no longer mention homeopathy. And that is why, whether it is Hanumanian, Dr. Dhawale, or Dr. Sehgal, they have meeting points as a holistic perception and meeting point as an individualistic. The approach, the orbit may change. Fundamentals do not. Because these fundamentals are so natural that it can't be changed. Nature cannot be changed. Whatever is artificial, whatever is hypothesis, whatever are the speculations, there you have to go on changing. And so there is so much eternal truth about homeopathy. Hence, there cannot be any revolution in homeopathy. I'm sorry. Homeopathy has remained consistently same. Okay, what was the revolution that Dr. Dhawale brought forward? He was the one man who brought a standardization, and he insisted about the integration in homeopathy. What is that? He emphasized standardization in education, clinical practice, and research and excellence, center of excellence. There has to be a standardized approach for teaching, and there should be a standardized product as a homeopath, one who comes out. If the car of a one particular brand that comes out of the factory, all of the same model looks alike. We all are following the same curriculum, same syllabus, maybe different universities, but even then, there is a one standard syllabus that everybody has to follow. But then, why the products are not standardized? Why physician efficiency is of a different level? Efficiency has to be a little different depending upon everybody's capacity. But there cannot be so vast gap. And that is what the revolution he brought, and he insisted and worked for 30 years for standardization in homeopathy. For that, he focused on clinical assessment, case processing, treatment planning and programming, and progress assessment. All the three things have to work together. They have to be together hand to hand. And for that, what a physician has to have are tools. Physician has to have definite concepts. he gave me so many tools. This is not a platform and a forum to discuss all the tools. He gave tools for the clinical assessment. So clinical session evaluation form, where physician is given immediate feedback from the observers so that he evolves as a unprejudiced observer. Likewise, case processing, in that most important is standardized case record. Standardized case record is not only the recording, but it is also a processing tool. And it is such a processing tool which gives immediately your feedback like a mirror about your work, working style and your efficiency level. It remains throughout with you during clinical assessment, case processing and planning and programming in progress assessment. This is a standardized case recording system. And a physician required to have medical, homeopathic and material medical knowledge, whereby the perception and the integration, applied knowledge, having perception, it is not only the collection of the data. In aphorism number 3, Hahnemann has demanded perceiving the knowledge. And it is not all about only perceiving the knowledge, but the capacity to integrate. And without that capacity, I cannot understand the portrait of disease, nor the totality of symptom. This requires to be done at both the end, natural disease as well as at artificial disease. He also presented a revolution in physician development program and patient care. At the institutional level, then he went and had a homeopathic postgraduate college at Palghar, and not only that, homeopathic hospital and excellence centers, center of excellence, whereby the total focus is unprejudiced observer, evolving unprejudiced observer in the physician, homeopathic physician, and the entire science has to be evidence-based system. So that way I say, Dr. Dhawale presented a scientific part of the homeopathy. If we say homeopathy is a science and art, then Dr. Dhawale has presented a complete scientific part. I don't say artistic part was not there, otherwise he cannot function as a physician. Without artistic part, he cannot create things. But in that creation also, no hypothesis, no speculation, only facts, evidence-based system he created. He was the pioneer in presenting living material medical study, clinical research in homeopathy. His name of the institute, ICR, means Institute of Clinical Research and Synthetic Prescriptions. Dr. Otto Lesser is the pioneer about study of periodic tables. And then Clinical Farrington gave the group study, whereby Dr. Dhawale went one step ahead about synthetic prescriptions. Though that remained only in the lecture and notes of Dr. Kent, Natrum silicata, Calcarea silicata. So all those drugs were only on the pages. But Dr. Dhawale brought them out of the pages into the practice. Of course, I can talk for hours together, he being my teacher. Now I introduced about the revolution that took place in homeopathy, where Dr. M.L. Sehgal played a major role. He presented the artistic part of homeopathy, very delicate, very tender part of homeopathy. How to reach to the core of the sick. Why we need to reach to the core of the sick? Because totality of the symptom is outwardly reflected picture. That is to say, essence of the disease. Of the internal derangement of vital force. So something to do with the internal thing. Outwardly reflected picture is a sign of symptoms. The end results, pathology. But the root is there within. That Dr. Hahnemann put it as a disposition and fundamental cause. Where Dr. M.L. Sehgal made the point how to reach to the core of the sick. Core of a man, he said, is mind. Dr. Kent's guideline helped him to begin with. There is a man who is sick, and man comes before the sick disease. And we treat the man in disease, not the disease in man. And he put forward that disease leads to disturbance in assimilation and elimination. And if your drug is right, then it expresses disease out in the form of elimination. We can have a separate discussion at length what he means by assimilation and elimination. But as we have to respect time, and I'm very eager to listen to Dr. Obaid about the development about and the role of Afghanistan in the world of homeopathy. So, characteristic symptoms. Characteristic symptoms he defined very clearly. Predominant, persistent, and present. These are characteristic symptoms. Three P's. And then exploring the disease, case taking, defining the case, reaching to the level of the case, understanding case, perceiving. Thereby, he put it that mind can be traced in his common talk when he is his usual self. When patient comes and sits in front of us, he is totally guarded, or he has been taught right from the childhood how he has to respond to the doctor. He has to talk to the doctor about his complaints, his problems, this difficulty and that complaint and that complaint, this pain and that disability and whatnot. He has to constantly talk about that. It is something like that. If I go to bank, with the banker, I talk about money, I talk about my passbook, I talk about my transaction. So that way, patient goes to the doctor as a client, and a doctor attends the patient as a professional man. So that is why patient is guarded. He has to talk to the business. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are my problems. Across the counter, these are my problems. Now you give me the medicine to get me rid of these problems. That's all. But Dr. Sehgal put it across. When person is off the guard, when his usual, so that common talk, when patient enters and talks, before he starts telling his complaints, at the end, when everything is all over and patient gets up, and at that time, whatever he puts a question is, or the how he says bye to the doctor, or he goes out and comes back again, everything has a common talk that makes the case defined. A different aspect he put forward. And do not restrict just on the face value of the talk of the patient or rubrics if you are referring repertories. What our patients say does not mean that is what he is conveying. And for that, we have to pay attention to what he says, what he does, what he says, how he says. So what he says, how he says, why he says, and in connection to God, whatever he says, what he does, whatever he says, how he does, why he says, and what he does. So his talk and his behavior, his talk and his action, we have to understand that.
This is the National Revolutionary
Some participant wants to say, convey something. Dr. Yashika?
Yes, sir. No, there are no comments right now.
Okay.
Yes, sir. You can continue, sir.
Okay, thank you. Meaning given to the sickness, reaction to the sickness by the patient, that makes entire sense about the person as a whole interacting with the sickness within. And purpose of treatment of the disease. Why has he come for the treatment today and why to you only? These are all common things that will reveal the inner core of the patient. What is revolution? Revolution is a sudden, radical, fundamental change. In homeopathy, a sudden, radical, fundamental change happened in 1796. And that was by Dr. Hahnemann. It was termed as homeopathy because it was based on law of similia, and drug is homeopathic if it is selected in law of similia. I'm just revising for you. Homeopathy underwent into phases of development and refinement. It being from nature's law of cure, its fundamental law of cure remained unchanged even after the centuries. Hence, importantly, changes occurred from time to time in only skills of its implementation, refinement of concepts, and to nothing else. The changes occur only in the skills of its implementation and refinement of concepts and tools. Revolution is need of a time in homeopathic education and training for standardization to have efficient homeopathy. If you want to bring revolution, we have to address to this fundamental burning issue that is all over the world. Otherwise, homeopathy will remain only a rudimentary, not alternative science. It will become a rudimentary science. So all the fraternity people has to come together. By being a academician, I just because of that I am not putting this on me. Even as a clinician, and when I see my students for 25 years, I understand that this homeopathy education standard, it is no standard at all. No. There is all the possibility that it can have a standard because our syllabuses are having a standard, our universities are having a standard, our college is having standards, our teachers are having a standard. But even then, why the students remain with confusion? Because there are many schools of homeopathy, many approaches. Multiple guidelines.
Assalamu alaikum, sir.
All are right.
Sir, ji pakhair jod tak la tik tak bas sundar to vital sign kita bas
continue please. Wo there was a disturbance from Dr. Hashmi's side.
No problem. We don't get disturbed at all from our brothers and sisters. Hai na? Yashika, but we give them time to express themselves. Okay, so many schools of homeopathy, many approaches, multiple guidelines, and all are claiming results, and all are right. Same patient, but different perceptions, different remedies. See, this is what happens with the newcomer. Where to take turn, which road to take, we don't know. Which school of homeopathy to follow. Relax, nothing to worry. Because if it is homeopathy, it must be based on law of similia, nothing else. You follow law of similia. And that is Hahnemann's revolution you follow, and you will be always on the right track. There exist no different schools, but only different skills for its application. So we keep this in mind, that there are no different schools, but only different ways of doing it, different skills. And you select one that is suitable to you, as per your aptitude, as per your capacity. And don't follow blindly, and don't be part of the herd. You just select what is right for you, or you develop your own skill. How to apply law of similia, that's all. Guidelines are there in the fundamental literature of Dr. Hahnemann. So let's go get back to the roots, to Hahnemannian homeopathy. Because that in real sense is a revolutionary therapeutic science. We make our fundamentals strong. We have multiple challenges, and more the challenges, more the opportunities. Corona, it is a challenge, but it has brought homeopathy in the eyes of the world. It has given the opportunity to homeopathy. Need of sound fundamentals, standardized education and training, standardized approach, non-compromising homeopathy, evidence-based medical homeopathy, and research. If we have this, we can convert challenges into opportunities. We first prepare us by making our fundamentals strong, reinstating our conviction by returning back to root for next generation evolution. Otherwise, though there is a potential of homeopathy to deal with epidemic, non-epidemic like corona infections. Since homeopaths were not standardized in uniform, court of law says we allow homeopathy, we don't mind, but at least you first come to one conclusion, to one opinion, to one approach, and that is this issue. So even if you want to bring the revolution, at least get our roots very strong. And so we attend to the first revolution in the therapeutic science, that is homeopathy, and that was done by Dr. Samuel Frederick Hahnemann. So before I proceed, I would suggest that we take the Hahnemann oath, because now I will be demonstrating a case. So when we are taking up a function, a role of a physician, we follow the directions given by Hahnemann. You may join with me. On my honor, I swear that I shall practice the teachings of homeopathy, perform my duty, render justice to my patients, and help the sick, whosoever comes to me for treatment. Maybe the teachings of Master Hahnemann inspire me, and may I have the strength for fulfillment of my mission. Thank you very much. So now, my rest of the talk will be to explore perceiving a Hahnemannian key, because we are going back to the roots. If any of the participants has to say something so far, I am open for the discussion. And what I will be discussing now, and Yashika, what I will be discussing now will be pure and totally Hahnemannian and its application. So those who are expecting me to something great about the revolution and revolutionary ideas, they may be wasting their time continuing with this webinar. But I tell you, trust me, believe me, that making our roots strong will only help us to grow and bring revolution, and the revolution that is required in the education and training. And that cannot be given unless if myself is in real sense is a homeopath. So we all, forgetting all whatever you have, the experience, my august audience must be having a vast experience of homeopathy, clinical practice. They may be teaching or they may be learning every day. For a while. Just leave them. If I am presenting my 40 years of the experiences, can't you leave your whatever you have learned aside just for 40 minutes? Let us have a pure thinking process, and with Hahnemannian key, so that we can unlock every individual case for homeopathic remedy. So, Yashika, if anybody has anything to say, Dr. Yashika?
I just checked. Yes, sir. There are no comments yet. I want to request the audience, if you want to speak or raise your hand or any queries you have, we can have a discussion in between and have an interactive session. Please post your queries in the chat box.
So far, whatever I have said is not theoretical, it is purely from experience. In homeopathy, there is nothing theoretical, because the science has evolved as a result of an experiment that has given certain experience, and that has been verified and then confirmed into the practice. And science went on evolving step by step, day by day, from the decimal potency to 50 millisimal potency, from the massive doses to the minimum doses. So every time there is a retrospection and correction. Homeopathy is not the science of theory. Organon is not the book of theory. It is the experience of Dr. Hahnemann, which he shared with us so that we can also become efficient like him. And with a true sense, we can become a physician who will have no other duty but to restore sick back to health. So far what I have said, that is extract of my 40 years experience being with so many teachers, world teachers, speakers, literature. 30 years of experience of Dr. M.L. Dhawale, just to concise into one slide, the life that Dr. M.L. Sehgal has given to homeopathy, just to put across in one small box, that is very difficult, very difficult. So that I have presented to you in a very concentrated form. So don't consider it as any philosophical or theoretical talk. Okay, so I proceed with the case. I stop sharing for a while.
Sir, you can continue. People are commenting that we are more to listen to more than interrupting. So you can proceed further with the session.
Okay.
And case.
Okay. Yeah, this case that is interesting, and why I brought to you this particular case. This case is of a physician. A lady physician, suddenly one day in my message box of WhatsApp, I got a message that needing an urgent consultation. So I brief you about this case, and you can interact without any hesitation. And this case is a very long case. I have made it as much as possible meaningful and concise. So all the details may not be over here, but if you feel any detail that is required by you, you feel free to ask me. I hope my screen is visible to everybody now. Is it Dr. Yashika? Hello. 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 Have I lost connection with you all?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir. It's all right. Please proceed.
Okay. Thank you. So I'll share it again. This is the Hanumanian key, which will help us to unlock every individual case. That is what is the important point, that every case is individual by itself. For selection of homeopathic remedy, means that is based on the law of similia. On 29th January, she approached me, patient of about 34 years. There seemed urgency, and she sent a brief history seeking consultation. She was having anticipation that on that day too, she otherwise would require nebulization. So why there was so urgency, why there was anticipation from nebulization? Okay, we understand there must be some airway disease. She approached clinic with her husband, who is also a surgeon. Our previous case detail was available to some extent. And what was to be treated in the case, that was explored. Treatment was started on 31st January. I'm again taking you back. On 29th, she said there was urgency and she was in distress. Other she would need a nebulization, she approached for the consultation, and what was to be treated was explored. On 31st January, next day morning, she replied that she is doing better by 30 minutes. The improvement began within 10 minutes of the dose. She couldn't lie down even then. Previous to the dose she started, she was already under the effect of the nebulization. Bronchodilators she had taken, no steroids. She could not lie down due to wheezing and she had to take nebulization. She was feeling better by 30%. She was comfortable, but she was not able to lie down and so she had to take nebulization. Obviously, she slept well. Got up fresh in the morning, cough was loose and feeling 20% better. And she said that she will inform in the afternoon, because afternoon onwards she usually goes into aggravation. She informed next day in the evening, feeling much better. Cough frequency was better. Afternoon aggravation of breathlessness was 70% better. She did not require nebulization. On 8th February, she said, after a week, doing very well now. She was told to inform on the daily basis, but she did not. Doing very well now, have stopped medicine since 3 days. Thank you so much. 7th March, she said, so that was after 1 month, she said, she is doing very well. She took medicine on and off, not regularly, not consistently, as and when she felt little, an allergy is better. Now she can withstand those allergens better. In June, she said she is blessed with a baby boy today morning and they are better. They are all fine. So that was the reason why she did not want allopathic medications. She came to homeopath and seeking homeopathic medicines because she was pregnant. just make note of points. I don't know what will make the case and we, what will turn out to be, what is to be cured in the case and what will have such curative power to cure the case. On 26 September, so after 3 months, she said, can she come and meet for her child? She wanted treatment for the child also. So why did I show you this? Am I interested in impressing you? Am I here to show a marvelous results? What is my purpose of coming and showing this case in this particular manner? Why we are astonished by results in homeopathy? Something which is happening once in a blue, something which is unexpected, something which is out of my reach. And if that is happening, then obviously it is marvelous, this is excellent, that is fantastic, that is a magic. If homeopathy is a science, the results should be replicable. I should be able to give results to all the cases. And all the homeopaths should be able to give the similar results. So results in homeopathy should not be by chance, but it should be our habit to get cure. So how do we unlock every case? Every key is designed. To match specificity of the lock. So every lock has its own specific key. There exists no master key. And it is said, if you go on applying the master key, then that will spoil the, it may open up, relieve the symptoms. But that will spoil the lock. It will disturb the equilibrium. So always use case-specific remedy. Never use disease-specific remedy. That is what this message is available in front of us. What is key? Oh God, I am talking everything other than homeopathy with you today. I took you to the history, but believe me, there is something so much extract that will help you if you have just noted down. The key. Now see, the key has different parts. We have a handle or a bow. We have a blade. We have serrations. We have a shoulder. Have you noticed this shoulder on the key? We have a shoulder and there is a tip. What does this mean to us? Oh, there is some number also on the key. What does all this mean to us? The bow is law of similia. That gives us a grip, that gives us the handle to handle the case. The blade is fundamental cause. That gives us strength to understand the disease. Okay, so what is shoulder then? Shoulder is perceiving every disease. Every key has a different kind of shoulder. So we have to understand what is to be treated in every individual case. And these cerations, the depressions and projections, they are indications of characteristic symptoms. Every case is projections and depressions. Every case is something to express, and there is always something that is suppressed. Does it sound interesting to you? Hello? Write in the chat box. The tip is mind and disposition. So what is the job? Both gives us the grip. Fundamental course gives us the strength. This holds the correct. The shoulder prevents us to probe more than what is required. Shoulder always tells us to see, just inquire, just probe as much to know what is to be treated in the case. Nothing more, even nothing less. Go up to the shoulder. We don't have to write biography of the patient, right? We have to know only what is to be treated in the patient. So it is all concerning to our business. It is all concerning to our job for what we are assigned. But that probe has to go only to the level where tip engages the other end. And that other end is a delicate point. And there is mind and disposition. On that becomes the pivot to rotate the key. And this particular key, when unlocks the lock, case is cured, then case says that it should not relapse back. And that is, we have to follow as a physician, guideline aphorism number 4. Key says, follow 4. That is, we are preserver of health. Curative power of every remedy, matching with pattern of every disease. This is something very important. So that is why knowledge of disease and knowledge of curative power. So what was that in the case, and how do we apply this key to unlock this case? This was received respiratory system. She was having the trouble since last 2 to 3 days. Allergic problem. She was allergic to dust and odors. And getting nasal mucous membrane affected, getting 3 to 4 paroxysms at the time of a severe, loud, forcible sneezing, shaking whole body of the patient, inflammation and running nose, whereby throat having the scratch sensation. She feels better by warm gargle, worse by swallowing, and she has allowed around the same time in January, there was a change of the weather. She was not sure whether it has done, but if it has done, then it has done severe effect. So once it is a query, this is getting nullified. Plus plus gets nullified. Draft of air, she is highly sensitive to. She took Cilicia 202 doses at that time. She actually wanted to take Calcarea Silicata, but it was unavailable. She took Cilicia and she was not better. Next day, the same complaints continued. And what had happened? She had taken ice cream. Why she had taken ice cream? With the feeling that not to worry now, Silly has been taken, it will take the care of the rest of the thing. So I can take ice cream. This is what she has written everything in the history. Since evening, cough, throat irritation followed by cough, dry. Too much irritation in throat and nose. See how it developed. Morning after waking and was lying down, mild frontal headache, bit of a steam. And here the sea. She feels bored to take steam. I wonder how she took ice cream when she knows that how much severely she suffers and she has to take nebulization. But even then she took ice cream. She knows that this is helping her. But even then she feels bored to take. Today, on 20th January, when she submitted the history, she had a hair wash in the morning. In such condition also, she took a hair wash. Cough with mild. Now, what began? Breathing difficulties and that progressively increased. That was worse by talking, laughing, lying down. Continuous wheezing and breathlessness to the extent that as if I would die. Usually I don't take treatment, but realized its fast progress, took the cough syrup which improved 75%, but that was with regards to cough. Though wheezing on lying down, that has to continue. Felt weak in whole body and sleepiness. Obviously, if that is having antihistaminics, then she will fall asleep only. And today she took calcium silicate, 2 doses, but no change. She took silica, she took calcium silicate. She did whatever best she can do by herself. That was not helping her. See, now she is in a desperate state. I don't want to take allopathic treatment feeling as if it would harm my child. Health-wise, I'm very weak, so feel bad about me and people around me. Because of me, now they will suffer. By night, was very breathless, worse exertion, worse exposure to cold air, and worse ascending stress. So no exertion was possible. Gasping and ascending. She was staying on the third floor. And hence, she had to take nebulizer of Duolin for 15 minutes. You know Duolin as a double bronchodilator. She also took mucolized syrup. Again, at 4 o'clock in the morning, got up with dyspnea, wheezing, waited for about half to 1 hour. It went on increasing, not able to lie down. Again, she had to take nebulization. Now, this is giving you the picture, what is the severity of her problem, and besides that, she was pregnant. She had such similar headache about 1.5 months back, whereby she had taken a cold drink. She knows that she is worse by cold things. She takes cold very easily, worse by a cold draft. But even then she took cold drink. Had to take nebulization with Duolin and it had settled down. She had taken ammonium carb, natrum silicate, natrum phos and calcium silicate as and when she felt indicated. And she felt better with ammonium carb to a certain extent. But it did not control dyspnea at all. She, at that time also, took nebulization. she is predicated of desire sweets, milks and eggs, especially milk. Very sensitive draft of air. Very chilly to the extent that she covers herself. Very thick covering she takes in all the seasons. She has written what is bothering me. She says, she begins with, I have not figured it out. No history form was given. She is writing by herself. It was just told on phone after the WhatsApp message that you just write down what is happening with you, how you are suffering, and write down if something is bothering you. Whatever is bothering you, you mention it. So she mentioned, sensitive to criticism. I feel so good with them. I will just summarize the case. It is a long case, but I will give you all the salient and features. And Dr. Arora, whenever you want me to end up, just tell me before 10 to 15 minutes. Patient is very sensitive to criticism. And patient cannot make answer. She wants to. Because when she speaks back, she answers back, she speaks too much. And then she feels bad why she did that, all those things to hurt people. She wanted to be in good books of everybody and not hurting, behaving bad. I feel upset that why did I even give them a chance to comment bad about me? I should be capable enough to do things that I am criticized for, but I am not capable. I am incapable. And these points were confirmed. If I am good, others would be also good. That is why she prefers to be good. Short-tempered, get upset easily. So if I don't remain good, they will not be good. If they are not good, I will be affected because of their criticism. And I don't want to have that because I will not be able to answer back and I will suffer within. She's short-tempered. Sensitive to rudeness and criticism, feel insulted. So what happens with the criticism? She feels insulted, feel others having no respect for her. Why they have no comment? Why they have to comment? That is the first thing she says. Why they have to comment only on me? And when she's angry, she trembles. She gets so much anger and excitement. She wants, but she cannot speak. But that trembles her and she feels insulted. She says, the others have no respect for me. She doesn't approve those criticisms. She feels insulted, even the slightest rudeness. So I convert to symptom. Oversensitive to criticism and slightest rudeness, she feels indignated. Anger, easy, gets excited with sadness about their behavior and later about behavior of herself also. And she trembles when she's angry. It is good to others so that they too remain good. She goes into the remorse, blaming to self that no adequately capable enough. She says, I am inadequate. That is her pain. This is bothering her. So she disapproves their hurting behavior. At any point of time, Dr. Arora, if anybody raises hand, I am open for the discussion. I proceed ahead. Bother about others' comments that if she was not capable to upbring or manage two kids, even then she opted to be pregnant for second child. See, others may be guiding her, giving her suggestions that it was not the right time for her to go into the, for having the second baby. Now she is taking that as a criticism, and that she is taking as a insult, that she is not even capable to bring up two children. She does not have confidence that she would be able to upbring two children, as the first one is pampered and possessive about things. So this creates lots of anxiety in her for second child. Will I be fair with both of them? Elder child is very understanding, but I should be very, should be able to deal smartly. Just see all the common words with both, so that there remains love between them and no rivalry. If I am not able to manage them, there will be my fault or my lacuna. Despite trying my best, I will not be able to manage them. That throughout goes on in my mind. So I search and read articles too on how to manage two kids and discipline them. So she searches if she can get some guidance from anyhow. Want to raise them as good. ये सारे पॉइंट्स आप मार्क करते जाओ. यू गो ऑन नोटिंग डाउन ऑल द पॉइंट्स एंड दैट विल हेल्प अस इन अंडरस्टैंडिंग दिस पेशेंट. वांट टू रेज देम एज गुड ह्यूमन बीइंग. इफ नॉट, पीपल विल से दैट आई डिड नॉट पे प्रॉपर अटेंशन टू किड्स दो आई डिड माय बेस्ट. सो इन द केस टेकिंग दिस वाज कंफर्म्ड. सो सिम्टम्स आर एंजाइटी, लैक ऑफ कॉन्फिडेंस, फीलिंग ऑफ इनएडिक्वेसी, टेंड टू ब्लेम सेल्फ, कॉशियस, exploring literature, think of tactful upbringing of the children so that they have no rivalry, sensitive to criticism, and searching the data by herself, opting for the guidance. All this is a good thing. Why the point is, symptom is feeling of distress. When all these things become the point of a distress that makes, compels person to do that, or person has no control, or person has no choice but to do that, so that it becomes a symptom. On 30th January, when they came, what was found? That discharge was tricky, difficult to bring out. Nebulization was taken twice. Cough was aggravated, or took all the treatment. Rhinorrhea and violent sneezing, that was shaking the whole body. Throat irritation is always the first sign that now she is going to get the cold. And recurrent bronchitis. So antibiotics she takes, or either it becomes all right of its own. What she means by insulted? This is something very interesting. So what she says? Insulted, as if without will. Useless, non-living, non-reacting. She feels how people are behaving, criticizing, passing comments, is that she is feeling as if I have no worth, as if I am not having any value, I am useless, I am non-living, I am non-reacting. And moreover, just see, as if I am mad naked. There is nothing to left over to cover. If you understand Hindi, patient ko kya lagta hai? Mujhe aise bolte hai, jaise ki main mujhe puri nangi kar di. As if made naked. Obviously, that will lead to lots of anger, but not able to speak. Body starts trembling, feel like talking, but it may not be expressed correctly. That is another anxiety. She feels embarrassment, ashamed, so much that not able to speak for even herself. Feels she should have answered, but she blames herself. Why am I like this? No courage with feeling that she may speak inappropriately to the circumstance. So symptoms are indignation, considering worthless, mortification, made naked, anger, trembling, unable to speak, as if would make mistake, embarrassment, ashamed, cowardice, timid. She feels, blames herself. She is very badly affected if not respected. She is affected by not respected, rudeness, not taken care, given importance, not acknowledged, rather made to feel worthless. She fears that can be harmed if alone in room after horror movie. Sullen shrouds, dark and ghost, fearful. Father was very strict, but father never reprimanded her because she was a good student. I had to remain in good book. I had to remain good. I have to be nice with everybody. The confusion about right and wrong, not able to take decision. Dreams, riots, if read, such thing. Wrong happening with child and she is helpless. So happening. There is a lot of mishappenings, misfortune. There is a point of harm happening and feeling of helplessness. In real life also what is happening? She becomes helpless. She can't manage the situation. She doesn't know what to do, what not to do. Obviously, it is a clinical diagnosis, hypersensitive airway disease, allergic asthmatic bronchitis. Any other classification? Obviously, you are right. It is chronic disease. Having acute exacerbations periodically. It is dynamic because it is progressive. And it is a result of the internal imbalance of the energies. Miasmatic because it is hypersensitive reflecting sora. Fully developed, having characteristic mind and disposition. In aphorism number 6, Hahnemann has said, portrait of individual disease, portrait of disease. But every individual case has to be treated. So we have to create a portrait of every individual disease. So it has two points. One point is deviation. That includes morbid phenomena, causes, progress, and pattern. Phenomena cannot be without the origin. It has to have evolution. So obviously it will have patterns. So deviation is about morbid phenomena, accidents, and symptoms. And disease in whole extent of the sick. That is what he writes at the end of the, what should be the portrait of the disease? It should be in whole extent. And that is comprising of subjective symptoms and objective signs. So here, attempt has been made to make the portrait of the disease, whereby this 34 years patient, since 2 to 3 days, the picture of hypersensitive airway disease with a cough, cold, violent shaking, sneezing. And why she has come here for the treatment? To avoid harmful effects of allopathic treatment on the child. So this shows her cautiousness. 1.5 months back, she had similar problem and sensitive cold is confirmed. Recurrent allergic asthmatic bronchitis begins with throat irritation. Discharge is a sticky, difficult to bring out. Usually, things come up suddenly and gradually develops to its severity. So this is allergic inflammatory recurrent airway disease. In general, we find there is oversensitivity. We find at the body level, allergic inflammatory recurrent airway disease itself is an oversensitive immune response. We see oversensitive at the level of the disposition also, very sensitive to cold, tendency to catch cold, desire for sweet eggs and milk, but more so for the milk. It was not much for the sweets. Mind is also oversensitive. We see she was childish. No, there was no much of the maturity, as per the husband had said, that there is no much of the, that she can't handle situation of her own. We see here frivolousness and heedlessness in the patient, things which are troubling her, even then she does that. She is easily impressionable and she wants to be felt special and important. When she is not given care, if she is not given importance, if she is not given worth, that affects her. Lots of tenderness. Tender about criticism, blames, not given importance. Easily getting hurt. Lots of insecurity, anxiety about the harm, should not be harmed. This particular idea is coming up when she reads riots or she sees movies of ghosts. So all such harm, my child should not be harmed. I should not be taking that medicine which will trouble. So all this situation makes her cautious. Anger. Everywhere, whatever is coming up is severe. Anger is aggression, non-acceptance, suppression, leading to indignation, mortification, and in anger she wants to speak out and she will speak a lot of things, but she has to prevent it to remain in the good books, and so there is lots of trembling inside. Nakedness, feeling naked, sadness. We find as a result, what is coming out is weak will, inadequate sense of inadequacy, timid, nervous person, cowardice, cautious, repentance and guilt. And her defense is to be good. We have to understand what is the cause, what is the effect. I have made that attempt here. So that what element says in aphorism number 7, outwardly reflected picture of the internal essence, that is to say, the internal derangement of vital force. So we should not be getting carried away by the outwardly picture, but we have to understand what is the essence. And this essence is very much connected with the internal derangement. So attempt is made here that what is outwardly reflected picture. Actually, the problem is deep within. That is at the level of the in the core of the person. Confused. Follow others' opinion to please and for the peace. Lack of confidence. Indecisive. These are some of the, if I have overlooked some of the features that I have said earlier. This is in total a portrait of the disease where everything is arranged in connection with each other, with they're maintaining the relationship so that it gives a picture of suffering. Now the attempt is making a totality of symptom. Participants, has any question? Anything they want a clarification? can be whether it can be autoimmune, considering immune aberrant immune responses, and again the conflict within self versus self, our conflict with our own people and our conflict within herself to say, not to say, I don't know, I can't take decision, this is right, that is right. She is undergoing the conflict. So self versus self and the conflict, usually that generates autoimmune response. And a study said that hyperimmune allergic responses or atopic responses are found to be turning into autoimmune disorders. Still, work is on research. Papers are available on net, not written by me, but I am following other scientists. So whatever is happening is sudden, whatever is happening is intense. So totality of the symptoms, it is again a rearrangement of the essential points, not everything that we have seen. So she can be having oversensitivity for the welfare of the child that was baby in the womb, fetus. And this shows about her cautiousness, and cautiousness otherwise also, which was evident from her earlier case record. Attacks were having these characteristics that we already seen, that throat irritation was a scraping type. It begins suddenly and then it goes to the severe, and allergic to so many things. Discharge are sticky and difficult. We are repeating same thing again and again and again and again. That is what Dr. Kent has said, don't abbreviate the case. Do it 1,000 times. The same thing. What happens? We know a lot of things. And we hear 1,000 times. Apply law of similia, don't prescribe on common symptoms, prescribe only on the PQRS. And then it becomes, we are used to it to the extent that we start neglecting and avoiding it. So don't do that. That is what I always tell to myself. That what is required is not to abbreviate the case. Same data patient gives. That is the purpose that want to inform me. Then I do analysis and evaluation of the case. So same data, now I am using to find out what is common and what is characteristic. Then the same data I am using to evaluate, to give the hierarchy, to understand what is striking, what is singular, what is peculiar, what is uncommon, characteristic symptoms. So once I do that, then the same data I rearrange now in a particular combination and the arrangement, the entire data which is available without avoiding anything. Now I picturize the thing. And from that, now I know what is the essence. I extract the essence and I combine them in the manner so that I can represent the sickness of the patient. And what is to be treated in every individual case is the totality of the symptoms. Her body is sensitive, likewise mind is also very sensitive to criticism, blames, insults, rudeness, disrespect, that she is not valued, she is not acknowledged, she feels indignated, and mortification at a time, feeling that she is made naked, left with no covering, embarrassment, feeling her very angry, she trembles, feel aggressive to react back with force, non-acceptance. And the point is that I have to be nice, and in the process of that nice, I am confused, I am no confidence, does not know how to react, what to react. I make them feel good or I may hurt them. They may then criticize me more. I save myself by remaining good to them. But the fight goes on within. And I was just wondering, is it a psychosomatic disease? So much oversensitive mind, so much oversensitive body. What is happening to the body, the bronchospasms, the inflammation, when mind is so much into the spasms, the mind is in so much of the hurts? That question remains in the mind. So now I just put across to the group what remedy they think of. I am open for the suggestion.
Thank you so much, sir. I'll just check if we have any queries in the chat box. The people were just suggesting the medicine staff, Calgary Arts, Phosphorus. No right. Questions yet.
Yes, Calgary
Arts. Also fast and gentle.
Yes, Phosphorus is also a good suggestion. Anything else?
Pulsatilla's Chappi Segria, Calgary Arts.
Okay. Yes.
Any other
suggestions? Adila, Steffi Segria. So that is what we have to understand, the core of the patient, the core of the problem. The core is about the hypersensitivity and the suddenness and the severity, which is making, and one side hypersensitivity, at the other side feeling of inadequacy, incapability, and the specific things of feeling naked, going into so much of the indignation and mortification because of the criticism and rudeness of others. Steffi Segria apparently appears that one part of sensitive criticism and rudeness and indignation and mortification. But is there such sullenness and severity? We don't. Phosphorus, yes, has rapidity. But whether phosphorus has such frivolousness and sensitivity to feel indignation and mortification. See, we don't follow the rubrics, just blindly the rubrics will not help us. We have to understand what is happening to the patient. Internal turmoil. Can we perceive that? Calcarea ours is a good suggestion. Dependency and restlessness and uneasiness. But calcarea ours, if we see one thing, it is not fully proved. We can put it as a synthetic prescription. In calcarea ours, when person is so much in restlessness and so much of distress, anxiety, insecurity, then the vagal stimulation, that is very obvious, autonomic nervous system comes into the play, and the loss of palpitation is one of the things. Here patient is having trembling. So I don't know if you agree with all this differentiation.
Thank you so much, sir. There were more suggestions like cocculus also.
Yes, cocculus, yes. Then what else?
Pulsatilla staff again.
Yep. Pulsatilla having so much of aggression within and not breaking down. The pulsatilla threshold is considered to be low. Whereas this patient as such holds everything within and entire severity is diverted to self. Okay, I know that I have to just give the message what I want to convey. At the outset, at the first instance, when patient told all these things, then it was noted that conflict that patient is passing through, the anxiety, the feeling of insecurity, the feeling of harm, being so much cautious, and I am not adequate. That she is not rich with the strength, she is poor in her strength. Poor in her sustenance, the delusion poor she is, delusion naked she is, ailment from indignation and mortification, ailment from anger. Embarrassment, suddenness, sudden effects, trembling with anger. Feeling she is so important. She is seeking importance everywhere. That is why she is getting disappointed and she feels I am insulted. She feels herself so worthy, pompous. So all these things lead to with fears of dark and fears of ghost. It led to remedy stramonium.
And thank you so much.
Stramonium,
sir. Yeah, more suggestions like delusion, poor, sorinum, antim tart, natrum muse, stramonium, lycopodium, nitric acid, parsulf.
Yes, Noxomica. So after giving stramonium 0/5, from the first dose itself, patient started improving and you have the follow-up. Now today morning, she mailed me giving the latest follow-up. I will share the screen and I will take your very few minutes, Yashika.
Sure.
I'm thankful to you for giving me so much of time, accommodating me and helping me to share what I really wanted to convey. Last follow-up is today. The intensity and frequency of the bronchitis has reduced. It has been almost a year, but I had no bronchitis episode. Means it is a year has passed since the last bronchitis episode. Took allopathy at that time because I did not have homeopathic medicine with me when I was traveling. Though I have allergic rhinitis with a lot of clear mucus, not as viscid as it used to be earlier and easily comes out, but it's manageable. So that difficult discharges, sticky discharges has become easy one. I have not taken any medicines up till now since that episode. So only once she has taken allopathic medicines because she was traveling. And even then, in 1 year, hardly there are any intense attacks. She is in the same family now with two children, looking after them. And she was not coming for the treatment or reporting to the clinic because she said, I hardly find time. Even I don't find time to sleep. Mentally, sensitivity to criticism and being judged by people have reduced. It still affects me, but the intensity is not that severe. Otherwise, it would have led to bronchitis. So now, whatever I was my missing link, psychosomatic, I understood the psychodynamics. But the psychosomatic correlationship, she told in the follow-up and on phone to me, that in the morning, she gets wheezing. If previous day, some such intense situation had occurred, but now there is only mild wheezing and that she gets over without medicine, it doesn't turn into the bronchitis as before. I have started to bother less about what people will think about me and don't take it on heart as earlier. I am happy with my family and two kids. She says further, because son's treatment was also taken, my son also is much better with the treatment. He does not have any episode of cold, cough or bronchitis. His skin condition is also very much better. Atopic dermatitis he had developed. He is active, playful and a naughty child as he should be. Now the point comes up here that is very important for us. In my entire family, there happened episodes of gastrointestinal symptoms. One after another at an interval of 2 days, all had similar symptoms. This happened during this COVID-19 period. Vomiting 7 to 8 episodes with abdominal pain, diarrhea followed by fever ranging from 99 to 102. All were given symptomatic allopathic treatment, excluding me and my son. I did not take any medications and settled early with least symptoms. And my son, he was given just one antiemetic, that's all. And his fever, there was 99 or something, and that settled out. We suspected it as COVID-19, as all fell sick with similar symptoms, one after another. There are changes at very deep level, and homeopathy has enhanced our immunity, which helped us in fighting disease. So this is what, if the key is right, and key that is matched with all the indications, with the final tip which rotates, the entire key rotates on mind and disposition. If applied on the law of similia, then irrespective of for what stramonium is known, if stramonium is the specific key to unlock that case, that will unlock it. And here, what helped was scientific aspect of Dr. Dhawale, an artistic aspect of Dr. M.L. Sehgal. And remaining on the facts, when we proceeded in a standardized manner, integrating artistic and scientific things together, then that key is formatted. And for that, important steps are in preparing the key is identifying your disease in its nutshell. The problem should not differ every day. Patient problem has gap means there is a problem. We have to find a patient in the person and help him resolve this patient and make him full person. So Hanneman and Key says every individual case, case specific, not the specific to disease. And we remain rooted before we make any further progress. The fundamental will never deceive you. Have conviction in fundamentals. That was the revolution in the therapeutic science by Hanneman at the end of 17th century, and it still holds true because it is true science, a true revolution. And always practice of integrated manner has helped me when I don't compromise on disposition and the core of the case, keeping fundamental in the mind, fundamental cause in the mind. So this was the message I want to convey. We all will bring the revolution in homeopathic field, but let us bring education and training, and let us have homeopaths as a standard production with efficiency and ability.
Thank you now, so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir. I think all queries were clarified, and it was such a wonderful presentation, explaining each and every aspect and how to crack the case. How, like, you have very well described everything. So thank you so much, sir. I want to invite Dr. Ubaidullah Al Hashmi, sir. Are you with us?
Yes, I'm here.
Thank you so much, sir. So without wasting any more time, I want to invite you and request you to start your presentation. I've already uploaded it. You can see on the screen.
Thanks a lot for allowing me much of time for completing my presentation. Now please go ahead. We are eager to hear you.
I want to say thank you, Dr. Kamlesh Mehta, Professor Saab. It was a really great honor and a nice presentation. I hope all audience learned something from us. First of all, I want to say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Thank you so much. I am extremely thankful to the organizers of this wonderful webinar series and given us the opportunity to AHMA to share our presentations about the homeopathy. And this webinar has been arranged by the BJN group of companies associated with the AHMA Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association. I am very thankful to Mr. Manish Jain, sir, the director of BJN, Dr. Yashika Aroda, the organizer of mandator of this webinar series, and also Professor Dr. Kavita Chandak, who is the lead of this webinar series. And the Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association, this is our first webinar series we have arranged internationally. And we have very great scholars, speakers in this program, as you know better. I will mention the names later, but first of all, I want to start that this homeopathic revolutionary international webinar has been collaborated, arranged with the Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association and Homeopathy 360. Let me introduce myself shortly. I am Dr. Ubaidullah Hashmi, the founder and president of Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association and the medical director of one of conventional hospital, the Legend Hospital of Afghanistan, based in capital of Kabul, Afghanistan. And this revolutionary international webinar speakers, first of all, thank you so much, Dr. Michael Frost, who is the professor of medicine reverted to the homeopathy. Second, Dr. Elizabeth and Muhammad Kareem, Dr. Kavita Chandak, Dr. Kostas, Professor Kamlesh Mehta sir. Right now the presentation has been finished. And Kathy M. Lehman, and Javed Akhtar Saab, and Dr. Manny Mehta, and all above mentioned presenters and speakers, they are the executive committee members of Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association. And this is a great honor for having these special personalities of this homeopathic world. The last one is Dr. Bahar Yawazi. She is an Afghan homeopathic doctor, but she has not still not been associated with AHMA. Today, I will be talking mainly about only a few issues. I don't want to waste more time because the audience maybe you have been tired. But when we are learning, we don't feel hesitate to stop. We have to learn something. My topic is the journey of homeopathy, the short journey, what the homeopathy system has been occurred in Afghanistan, what's going on and what we are doing. The first, the Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association. Afghanistan, every day we are shortly introducing the AHMA. AHMA is a non-profit and non-government organization serving the national with the expert of homeopathy. Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association has been founded in 2018, this has been found, and we started from zero. In 2012, some of friends has been has started the homeopathic medical system to be recognized in Afghanistan. Thank you, all of them. They have struggled, they have worked, but later on, all the program has been postponed, and then again from the zero we started in 2018. This association working for the purpose to recognize and regulate and establish the homeopathy in Afghanistan. Whenever we start with the thought of to work in Afghanistan, thank you God, thanks Allah, and with the grace of Almighty, we have found the great and special and worldwide scholars. They motivate us to work not for Afghanistan. Now we are ready to work for the homeopathy, for the development of homeopathy worldwide, globally. The purpose of AHMA is to support and unity of the homeopathic professionals in the world. What is our mission? The mission is very simple. The AHMA, Yashika, next please. Okay, let me, I will do the next, okay. I think it takes some time. Maybe there is a picture or what? Okay, let's next. Next, please. My internet is a little bit slow here in Afghanistan, you know. So many problems are here sometimes.
So the slide right now is about vision and mission.
Okay, no problem. We come to the mission. The mission is same. We are working only with, I am telling you everything very simple, very, very simple. The mission is work for homeopathy, for the development, for the recognition, for the people, for the patients, This is the machine. I'm telling you very simple. I'm not reading from the screen, sorry. Okay, next please. Come to the vision. The vision is to see the homeopathy formally established within Afghanistan healthcare and globally. Because we start from the Afghanistan, we have to give the priority to my country, which is there is no homeopathy. We have to establish here and then we will spread and to the globe. Next, please. Division. Okay, overall goal. Establish a regularity. Okay, establish a regulatory framework for the homeopathic medical system to provide the complementary, alternative, affordable, safe, and efficient healthcare services through the homeopathic branch of the medicine to all humans, especially to the poor countries like Afghanistan. Next, please. Afghanistan's short history since 2018. I want to tell you very shortly that whenever we found this association, the first achievement and the first step was we have found this association with the collaboration of all associations of Afghanistan and deliver so many presentations in private sectors and the government sectors. I mean, the Ministry of Public Health, Ministry of Justice, and some other relevant organizations, government and private organizations, like private medical universities, hospitals. We have give the presentations about the awareness and understanding of homeopathy. And first we start the awareness of homeopathy in the within the Ministry of Public Health. Even the people were not aware what is homeopathy, they were asking. Later on, the people understood, and now thanks Almighty that the people understand and they support the homeopathy also. The next step was linking the AHMA with the many international organizations, and this has been developed after my first visit to India for the WHD World Homeopathy Day, the Hanuman birthday in New Delhi. And I met some friends who are came from the different countries in different states of the India, and I have learned how to success this association and organization which working in Afghanistan. That was a very great honor for me. Also, we have we had some meetings with Ministry of Ayush, with CCRH, and also we have the Ministry of Ayush proposed us to come with us and sign the MOU, and it was also a great achievement for Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association. Also, we have arranged some visits to India with our government officials to understand the homeopathy, because if we are giving the presentation, they were not so much motivated to believe us, to understand homeopathy. We show them practically to visit India, to visit some research centers, manufacturing companies, hospitals, universities, the PG universities, and different facilities of the homeopathy. And it was a huge and enough source to understand our health professionals who are the delegation was from the Ministry of Public Health of Afghanistan. And organize some hosting the series of webinars. Like this is our first webinar. We have arranged this with the 360, and next time we will arrange more and more. We are looking forward to involve and more activities for understanding, for learning homeopathy, and for teaching homeopathy. This is the Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical. Next, please. Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association executive committee members. And world-based homeopaths, we have in our association and executive committee, and so many are, but we didn't include it here yet. Very soon we will publish the new update list. Like we have some legends, deputy ministers from our Ministry of Public Health, like Dr. Abdul Qadir Qadir is a deputy minister. Dr. Mohibul Azir, he is the director general of the curator department, Ministry of Public Health. The third one is the Dr. Ataullah Sayyazi, director general of management information system, health information system of Ministry of they are supporting, they are the big supporters of the homeopathy and the government sector. And also we have a really sorry friends, due to the disconnection. Hello, am I audible, Dr. Yashika?
Yes sir, you are audible.
Okay, you know the situation of Afghanistan, always the problem is occurs with me and with all here in Afghanistan around us. Okay, the HMA achievements, next please, next slide. What are the achievements? The AHMA has become the official institutional member of LMHI, Lega Medicorium Homeopathica Internationalis, in 2019. And it is the great pleasure for being the first institutional member of one of the international association of homeopathy. And I'm requesting all associations, all and all organizations, institutions, please, join us with your institution, because I don't want to request join us. No, we, this is a new association, AHMA. You people join us, request us, we are ready to sign the MOU. We want to learn, we want to teach, and we are ready to collaborate with any organization who are willing to collaborate us. And my first participation, as I mentioned, for the International Scientific Convention, WHC 2019. And next, please. I also mentioned in December, we visited Delhi with our government officials for understanding the homeopathy. And the presentation was given to our government delegate by Dr. Raj. The director of IUSH, and Nehru Homeopathic Medical College and Hospital. It was very brilliant presentation, and our government and the really after the for listening something new about the homeopathy. Thank you, Dr. Raj. If you are listening to me, I really salute you, sir. We also visited the Nehru Homeopathic Hospital facility, and our delegates interviewed some patients for the satisfaction and for
understanding how the homeopathy works. And the result was very positive. Also, we have visited the DDPR, Central Research Institute of Homeopathy, Noida, Paxson's Homeopathic College, some manufacturing companies. This was the group photo of whenever it was shooted in Nehru Homeopathic Medical College. My delegation, Dr. Abdul Qadir Qadir, the Deputy Minister of Public Health, and Dr. Mohibul Azir, the Director General of Curative Department, the great personalities of Afghanistan. I really like them, and they are the big supporters of homeopathy in Afghanistan. Dr. Raj is here, Dr. Bepen is here, and also the Director of All Afghanistan, Unani Medicine Director, Qari Shafiulla, Dr. Shafiulla Yusufzai also was the delegate of our visit. Next, please. Yashika, next. Yashika? Yeah, next, please. Next. Okay, in January, when we returned from the India, in January 11, I was officially invited from the President House of Afghanistan. It was very shocking news for me that I have got the official invitation of the President House that I have to deliver a presentation about the homeopathy. I was invited by the Dr. Faizullah Kakad, who was the Chief of Staff of the President Office. He is a PhD in toxicology, he is a best doctor also, and he is a politician. And I deliver the presentation, presentation about the homeopathy and how we need, why we need to in Afghanistan, what are the benefits, and in all aspects, the presentation was very successful. And they now, the President House is also the support, become the supporter of homeopathy. Next, please. This is Dr. Faizullah Kakad. The Chief of Staff for the President Office, the ex-Chief of Staff, Dr. Faizullah Kakad. And the letter is also in the left side. Yashika, next, please. Next slide. Okay. The other achievement, we also work on the conventional doctors to revert them to homeopathy, to increase the awareness among the health professionals of the conventional doctors in Afghanistan. This will be the great achievement when we start this project. Whenever we visit India, I request to the Dr. S.P.S. Bakshi, the owner of the Paxson's, if you provide the training, I will send you some conventional doctors to teach them how to treat the skin diseases homeopathically. And he accepted. He accepted and he said, yes, and free of cost, I will deliver all the facilities, trainings, accommodation and everything. Due to the corona, everything has been postponed. And after the ending this pandemic, inshallah, we will start this journey to teach the allopathic, the conventional doctors, how to treat the skin diseases. This will be the first training series for the conventional doctors of AHMA Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association. Next, please. Next slide. Yeah, this is the picture was shooted in the Paxson's during the visit of the Paxson Homeopathic College and University. Okay, next, please. And that visit, we also met Mr. P.K. Pathak, the additional secretary of the Ministry of Ayush. This meeting was arranged by Dr. Raj Manchanda, sir, and also Dr. Khurana, sir, the director of CCRH. Then the Ministry of Ayush proposes, please come, we have to sign G2G, MOU, government to government. And due to pandemic also, this still has been postponed. after the ending this coronavirus, the first task will be to sign the G2G MOU between the Ministry of Ayush and Ministry of Public Health of Afghanistan, inshallah. Next, please. This is the evidence picture, shoot it with the additional secretary, PK Patak sir. Next, please. Second report has been published. The first report was published in 2019. The HMA report was published officially in the list. And the second report was internationally published by Cleveridge, the Merck. And it was the second report that has been published by association. Next, please. Yeah, the recent activities. The recent activities last month, the AHMA became the task force of the AMC, Afghanistan Medical Association, Afghanistan Medical Council. Afghanistan Medical Council is a conventional medical council, and AHMA become the legal task force member of that. And second, AHMA also become the member of all Afghanistan FAMA, Federation Afghanistan Medical Association. This association has more than 30 associations together, and AHMA also become the part of it. And the presentation was organized by the member of by the first symposium has been done in Afghanistan in last month, and AHMA was the part of it. And this symposium has been done and presented in the President House in front of the President of Afghanistan. And this was, that was also the great achievement of AHMA. Next, please. This is the picture where during the symposium was being presented in the President House. The President of Afghanistan is there, and Minister of Public Health, Minister of Higher Education, and Director General of Afghanistan Medical Council, and all health advisors of the President House, and Director General of the Health Commission of Parliament of Afghanistan. So many legend and authorities were there, and the presentation has been presented for the betterment of how to make the health sector better in Afghanistan. It was the great mission, the first symposium of Afghanistan. I hope very soon we will have the own symposium, the homeopathic symposium in Afghanistan, with the collaboration of all international organizations. I am looking forward, who is interested to work for homeopathy, real homeopathy, and support the AHMA, please come join us to recognize and establish and develop the homeopathic medical system in Afghanistan. Next, please. If you talk about the education, there is no education. That's it. There is no education, and this is highly recommended to all homeopathic organizations in the world, how to start the education in Afghanistan. But one thing I have done from the Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association, the first batch will attend the BHMS in India and full funded scholarship by ICCR and Ayush. The candidates has completed their examination. They are waiting for the exception letter of the universities, and very soon they will join the BHMS in India and free of cost. All Ayush students, not only homeopathy, Ayurveda, yoga, and homeopathy and Yunani. Next, please. After education, if we talk about the clinical practice, as the homeopathy is not recognized in Afghanistan, there is no practice. If there is a practice, this is illegal, but the people are doing their practice with the context and something else, but homeopathy not been recognized. If there is no recognition, there is no license. Next, please. When there is no education, no practice, but how the homeopathic products will be available there? There is no availability of the homeopathic products legally. All the illegal products imported from the different various locations from different countries to Afghanistan. I also request all manufacturing companies, please come with us, come here, join us. How to import the products? We will make a great business here also. Along with the services, we have a business also. There is a great opportunity for the people who are willing to import the products and export the homeopathic products in Afghanistan. Please come and work in the fundamental of the recognition. Then we will go through the homeopathic imports and exports. Next, please. Okay. If everything, there is nothing, but why we want to adopt the homeopathy? Adopt for the recognition of homeopathy, introducing the homeopathy in Afghanistan, because Afghanistan is a very low economic country, the people are poor, and the homeopathy is the right choice for the people, because the Afghanistan people have more mentally disappointed. They have a mental problems. They have so many disorders are here. I don't want to discuss the disorders, but because the people are poor, the country is low economic. Because therefore, the homeopathy is an effective and efficient therapeutic system in the world. As everyone know, more than 500 million people are treating with homeopathy globally. Why we adopt homeopathy? Because this is, according to the WHO, this is the second largest system of the medicine. If allopathy is here, WHO is here. Why the homeopathy is not present in Afghanistan? We have to. And 35 to 63 cost effective according to the WHO. I have collected the data from. And suitable for everyone, like for the children, for the youngest, and for the old age. And not toxic and non-chemical side effects. No drug dependency. And also, if we recognize homeopathic medical system, it means we are connecting the Afghanistan with the world with the new revolution. We want to increase our contacts internationally with homeopathy, with other countries. Next, please. Okay, and last, we have request. If everything finished, then we come to the request of all from all homeopathic medical associations, organizations, institutions, and all departments to help the homeopathic system in our country. And why to help? Because we started from zero. Now we are maybe approximately in the 5 or 7%. We have achieved some goals within last 2 years. To help us in regard of establishment and regulation of homeopathy, because we have to recognize this system first. Secondly, we will go through the MOUs, country to country audible?
हाँ जी सर, यू ऑडिबल. हाँ जी हाँ जी.
ओके, रियली सॉरी फॉर डिस्कनेक्शन. एंड फर्स्ट आई टोल्ड यू दिस इज अफगानिस्तान, रियली सॉरी फॉर दैट. ओके, आई थिंक इट्स माय लास्ट स्लाइड, डोंट वरी. वी नीड द एजुकेशन हियर, अवेयरनेस अमंग द पीपल एंड डेवलपमेंट ऑफ होम्योपैथी. द फिफ्थ नंबर इज द क्लिनिकल प्रैक्टिस, बिकॉज व्हेन इट इज रिकॉग्नाइज देन वी विल एजुकेट. The awareness will come. We will develop the homeopathy here internationally, and then the clinical practice should be here, hospitals, dispensaries, and clinics, because this is the need of Afghanistan. This is cost effective, efficient, and especially for the poor people. And Afghanistan is the right place to recognize this system as soon as possible. Okay. This is very later on, but I have mentioned that we need to develop a clinical research programs and drug development and regulation. And drug manufacturing is not possible right now, but I have to request, because not today, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, it will happen in Afghanistan. And drug standardization. When we start importing, the government of Afghanistan has to control the drugs, the homeopathic medicines, dilutions, and combinations, everything. If they can do by themselves, or they will collaborate with other homeopathic institutions to organize the drug standardization department here. And medicine availability, this is my request to all manufacturing companies. Please contact us, contact AHMA through our website, official emails. Dr. Kavita is here, me here. And last, let me tell you one thing special. After the president after me, Dr. Shafak Shinwari, who is the telemedicine Afghanistan coordinator in government sector and also the vice president, he is the legal authority. You can contact, and you can contact me directly also, and you can contact Dr. Kavita Chandak. Contact us. We are here. We will work together. Because if we need you people, and at the same time you need us, because we cannot work individually. And when we get together, we can get success, we can work, we can help, we can earn, and we can do anything. Thank you so much for being with us. And one thing more and last I have to tell you, Afghanistan Homeopathic Medical Association start from Afghanistan, but right now we have in 14 countries representatives, and this is a great achievement, like in USA, UK, Bulgaria, Greece, Portugal, and France, India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, is also so many others. And this is a great achievement. It's everything due to all great members. And once again, I want to thank you, Dr. Kavita Chandak, Dr. Yashika Arora, and BJ and Company, all presenters, special and world best homeopaths who present their own presentations from the AHMA on behalf of AHMA. Thank you so much. And very soon we are going to organize another webinar, and all legend and speakers will be with us. And I request all of listeners and participants and audience, please be with us. And today, one thing I heard from Dr. Kavita Chandak ji, Professor Dr. Kavita Chandak, she says healing is my passion and homeopathy is my mission. If you give me a permission, I want to copy it. I want to say healing is our passion and homeopathy is our mission. I want to say it on behalf of AHMA. And AHMA is the equal property of all members, all homeopaths globally. Thank you so much. If anyone have any question, please.
Thank you so much, sir. I think all doubts are cleared and you presented so beautifully about AHMA and the status of homeopathy in Afghanistan. So thank you so much, sir. We have comments from Dr. Shrishti. It's a wonderful comment. I want to say thank you, Homeopathy 360 and AHMA, for conducting such an informative and great session with great speakers. Blessed to be its part. And really want to be the part of every activity conducted by both the associations. Please keep updating and notifying for me. Yeah, sure, dear. You can visit the website. She's also congratulating AHMA for this noble step and wishes its success and growth. So thank you, everybody. Dr. Shrishti. And also, I want to thank all the audience for being with us throughout this webinar series. It was a wonderful series organized on the international level, and we were having so great speakers from all over the world. So thank you so much, Dr. Kavita ma'am and Dr. Badrulal Hashmi sir, for being with us and organizing this event so beautifully. You want to say something, sir, because we have only 5 minutes left for this webinar.
Okay. I want to say something about you because you are the mentor and you are the key. You were the key of this webinar series. And without you, it was not possible to handle and organize in a better way. And I want to say thank you. And I have a special, I will tell my IT to make a special appreciation letter for you. And I think all audience, we have an e-certificate will be provided to all registered participants. Am I right?
Yes, sir. They'll receive the mail within 2 hours after this webinar, 2 hours, 24 hours, you can say. Because we'll be sending a webinar replay video after this webinar by night tonight. So in that only you'll have a Google Form link which you can fill and get the certificate.
Yes, Yashika, you will receive a special certificate by AHMA because you are not only working for any organization you are, but Dr. Yashika is the executive committee member and the active member of proud of AHMA. Thank you, Yashika, for your input.
That's so sweet of you, and it feels so great to know you as well as being in touch with you. I want to thank Dr. Kamlesh Mehta sir also for being with us and guiding so beautifully about the whole session today. Thank you so much, both of you. I hope the audience enjoyed, and thank you so much, audience, for your patient listening. Certificates information already told to you. We are already running a new, also running a series in the morning time. Tomorrow also we have Dr. Mahendra Singh sir series, and day after tomorrow also. So you can join us there if you want to. Yes, sir.
I have another comment for all homeopaths. If anyone want to join the AHMA, please contact us individually, or you have organization want to collaborate with AHMA. If any institution, manufacturing companies, universities or organizations, associations, please help us. We are new in this world, in homeopathy world. We want to learn and we want to teach. If we have a capability, we will teach. If we don't know, we will learn. Please get together to provide the right message on homeopathic medical system to the globe. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. You can also post the link of our Telegram group in the chat box if possible. Otherwise,
yes, I have shared already. Already I have shared.
So please share once again. People are asking already. Please share once again. So for any queries, you can WhatsApp also to me, or you can mail me at webinar@homeobusy360.com. And I think Dr. Kamlesh have joined us again. So thank you so much, sir, once again for a great session today. I personally really enjoyed and learned a lot from the whole session. So I hope audience also enjoyed. So we'll be meeting soon again, organizing another webinar series. And anything you want to say, Kamlesh sir or Hashmi sir, before I end the event?
Yes. I have shared the link once again. Please, everyone can join our Telegram group and Facebook group. Facebook group and Telegram group is open for everyone, but unfortunately in a WhatsApp group, the people are enough. We cannot add more, but we want to prefer the Telegram and the Facebook group, because we can add more and more than 100,000 people we can add. But unfortunately, the WhatsApp group is reserved only 250 or approximately a few we can add. But we have Facebook and Telegram. Please join us.
Thank you so much, sir. Kamlesh sir, you want to say something?
Obed sir.
Yes,
Kavita madam,
special salute.
And Dr. Yashika, it was a great time and it was a mega event. We say it is getting over, but I always believe that, and I again put across that when there is an end, there is always for beginning of something further. So whatever we have learned and whatever feelings we achieved this particular event, that will help us to do better for the next event. And since our intention is to reach out people and have the institutional relations and have the fellowship with the people around, then obviously there is no end to the event. But we look forward to always a further events. So my best wishes to Homeopathic Medical Association of Afghanistan, 360, and the team, and all the best to all the participants too. And I hope that they have learned what they have shared or they have gathered from this 1 week's time. That will be of immense help. Everything has come from the practice, and the purpose is only one thing, that we all evolve together and have the fellowship. All the best to you all.
Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful message. And thank you all, audience. We see you all tomorrow if you want to join our Dr. Mahendra Singh series. And you can register the same visiting our website. Also, we'll be coming up more. AHMA would be coming up with more webinar series and more plans. You will get regular updates through WhatsApp. So thank you, all of you. Stay with us. Stay connected with us. Thank you.
Because our website is under construction, so many things will be loaded very soon, still not been completed.
I think there is some connectivity issue. So we are working over our website of AHMA. Soon it will come up and you can visit the same. We'll be sharing the link on our Facebook as well as Telegram and WhatsApp. So I think sir wanted to say this only. So thank you so much. For any queries, you can mail me at webinar@homeopathy360.com. So we come to the end of the session. Thank you, Kamlesh sir. Thank you, Hashmi sir. Thank you.